When you're building this
web page and you've got, I don't know, content and a banner across the top and a banner across the bottom and ads down the side, content is being fetched from different servers to fill in all the chunks of that page. These might be ads, for example. And if the ISP can replace one of these with the ISP's ad server, then they've essentially kicked out this ad network from the process. So that ad network thinks that they're serving up an ad, but the ISP is replacing that ad with their own ad, which means the ad network's kind of paying for something which they're not getting. It also means that the ISP is getting the benefit of this very popular page, for example, you know, this might be the CNN front page, for example. And this ISP ad is now being inserted there in place. And so everybody who's going to the CNN web page, they're getting the ad that the ISP's inserted.
Got you. So surely that put a few people's noses out of joint, won't it?
Yes. Yes, it will. And it's something that's, you know, I guess it's not really considered good practice, but something that does happen. The problem with a lot of the original protocols used for the web is that they're completely insecure. So they're neither confidential, so all the data that you're transferring can be seen and observed by anybody who happens to be able to sit in the network and see that. They're completely unauthenticated. Even if you encrypt all the data so that nobody can tell what it is as it's being transmitted and received, you might not have any idea that you're sending it to the right person or receiving it from the right person. So that there's no authentication either. And as a result of this, it's possible to do a whole variety of attacks on traditional web protocols where you can intercept communication, for example, and maybe insert bad data into that sequence of exchanges, or you could redirect somebody to a different website than they thought they were getting to, because there's no, essentially the person who's making the communication, the person who's running the web browser, has no way to check that they're actually getting it from the real site that they thought. And TLS kind of fixes a lot of that by providing means both to encrypt the data in the communication, but also providing means to authenticate the sender and receiver so that you can tell that you're actually getting it from the website you thought you were getting it from.
I remember doing a video where we looked at how a website isn't just what you get from one page. It's made up of all sorts of things. So does that further complicate things?
It complicates things in the sense that when you get the original page will, so the first page that you go to, the URL you go to, will have some kind of base page. And then you'll fetch the data from that web server, and your web browser will start rendering that data and putting it up on the screen for you. And it will then be filling in holes in that data which have references to other objects on the web. So they might be simple images, they might be complex subpages, they might be adverts from an advertising site, there might be all sorts of things that are necessary to fill in the gaps in that base page. And because of that sort of complexity of that structure, you end up relying on a lot of other servers all doing the right thing and all behaving appropriately. And if those servers are in networks which are not the network to which you're initially connected, you might be fetching data from all over the planet in order to build that page that's going to be rendered. And because of that, just because of that complexity, that diversity, there becomes a lot of weak links, or a lot of potentially weak links in that. If you use TLS to encrypt all of those connections, you've got a better chance, and authenticate all of those connections, you've got a better chance that the data you're getting is the data you intended to get, and not the data that somebody who was in the middle of one of those networks inserted. You've got the, that's a symbol for a web browser. Let's go old school. Yeah, this is your web browser. And you've got the first server that you go to. I've got no imagination today. Server.com. So you're going to make a connection to that server and send a request, and you're going to get some page that comes back. And then you might have more requests that go to that server. You might have requests that go to other servers out there as a result of that. So this set of connections is one. And then you might have a bunch of other requests that all get sent out to a bunch of different networks, possibly multiple to the same. And then you have a bunch of things come back, and images come back, and ads come back. And this is what happens as the page is slowly being built. If you look at a web page where either this hasn't been fully thought through, or maybe you're accessing from a network that's a bit slower than normal, you might see this happening. So as the page renders, things move around a bit because bits of it are being filled in as the responses come back from the different servers, causing everything else to jump about a bit. The problem is that any of these connections, if these are all using HTTP, then there's no way for the browser to verify that the data that's coming back here is actually coming from this server. It could be coming from somebody else instead. And there's nothing inherently that stops that being the case. There's a bit of work that needs to be done for this attack to happen. If this guy just starts sending bad data to the browser and the browser's not expecting it, the browser will just bin it. Nothing will happen. In fact, the operating system will just bin it. But if this guy happens to be able to observe this initial request going out, it might be able to observe enough of the information there in order to be able to insert data before the response comes back from the real server, for example, which could significantly confuse things. So this is the sort of attack that will happen if you've got an ISP doing this kind of thing, for example. So if your network provider chooses to try and insert data onto the web pages you're visiting, then instead of you getting the data that comes back from the server, what happens is this is all going through the ISP's network.
It's simplistic to say we just ask a server for stuff, because there are all sorts of computers in a way, aren't there?
Yeah, so these packets that are flowing to make the request and the packets that are flowing to come back with the response, each of those packets could be manipulated and interfered with in some way. And so what can happen is that the packets come through here and then the ISP redirects those packets to the ISP server. And then you see these responses coming back from the ISP server. And there was no way for the originator of the request to tell that that was what they expected to happen, at least in the default case, as I said, with HTTP. If you have HTTPS, which means that you're using the protocol called TLS, then what happens is that there's an initial connection setup that happens. And so if the ISP tries to redirect these connections down there, then there will be an exchange that takes place before the request is sent, which means that this computer here will attempt to authenticate that computer there. And it will say, no, that's not the right one. That's not what I expect. So HTTPS is basically HTTP being carried on top of, or layered over, TLS, which is then layered over TCP. Normally speaking, HTTP is layered on top of TCP, IP, all the way down.
Then what happens is, with HTTPS, is if I'm going to example.com, I expect to get the right feedback from.
Yeah, so in fact, what roughly speaking, you have an exchange of certificates. So the connection is made, and then part of the initial negotiation that happens is that this server presents information to the client saying, this is some information that I could only have if I had access to this certificate. So go and check it against that certificate. And the client will say, okay, so I now need to go and find a certificate to check it against. There's actually a hierarchy that will sort of bubble back up to the top. So your server might be down here and your client's trying to access that. And they may have to check against multiple points to keep checking that it's been signed with the right certificate till you get back up to the top. And at the top, that certificate will be something that's actually embedded inside the browser. And so the client can then check against that, which it already has. And it doesn't have to rely on anything on the network to get that. It's got that built in. And if that checks out, then it knows that this sequence of signatures has been validated at every step. And so it can trust this server to be the server that it claims to be. The fundamental thing behind all of that is the idea that this server can only respond, can only provide that information if it has access to this secret. And that secret has been signed by another secret. And so you go back up the chain of these secrets signing other secrets signing other secrets till you get to one that you already knew. And at the point you're there, then you can be certain that that chain has not been fiddled with.
It's a trust thing, isn't it? Based upon somebody you know you trust, who they trust, who they trust.
And ultimately you get back to one that's built into the browser itself. One of the things that happens then is it becomes a big deal when another entity is allowed to put another certificate inside the browser. So you'll have a bunch of these that are embedded in the browser of these root certificates. And if you've got one of those root certificates, it means you can sign other people's certificates and they can then sign other people's certificates. And so you can end up, if you sign the wrong certificate for somebody, they can then go and create stuff which they will say okay to when they shouldn't.
I think we touched on this briefly when we did a Superfish video with Tom Scott. But what's happening now with this ISP then?
Well, so what's happening, for example, is you can have, there's a service called Let's Encrypt that started up where you can get your own certificates relatively lightweight fashion from this, which is a good thing in many ways because it means it's easier for people to do this. On the other hand, one of the things they had to do in order to make that service really viable was get their root certificate embedded in all these browsers. And so that means that these certificates no longer pop up and throw an exception and say, oh, I don't know where this one comes from. It's valid. You have a similar problem in a without involving Let's Encrypt, where you just have people doing what are called self-signed certificates. So the certificate that gets checked essentially doesn't have this hierarchy, it's just a certificate unto itself. And so the browser looks at that and goes, well, this is signed by itself, essentially. Or it's signed by the same entity that's issued the certificate, which means that on the one hand, this is going to be an encrypted connection, so it's all going to be fine and it checks out as far as I know. On the other hand, I haven't been able to ask anybody else to verify this for me. So it's still just you claiming to be whoever you claim to be. And I've got no other way of checking that out, which is why a lot of browsers, and increasingly browsers, will start to shout at you and say, this is a self-signed certificate, do you really want to trust this?
Watch your back.
Yeah, because there's no external validation that the entity who's done that really is the entity who says that they say they are. So you can have this sort of thing happening. You can actually have this kind of attack where the browser is trying to get to the server, the ISP server is used to intercept that. That can happen with TLS as well, because you can essentially have the connection gets rerouted down to the ISP server, and then the ISP server will manufacture a certificate with which to claim ownership of the address of the name that the client is trying to access. And if it presents that back, and the client believes, for example, in self-signed certificates, or the ISP controls enough of the chain of trust that they can produce a certificate that the client's browser will trust, then at that point, this server, to all intents and purposes, even on an HTTPS connection, appears to be the right server.
So one piece of advice for your humble user out there who's got all this happening behind the scenes, what would it be?
Humble user out there, shields up on your browser, right? Listen to the warnings. So if you've got, if things, you know, padlocks are not being closed and they should be, or the bar's in red, or you've got a warning pop-up saying, this is a self-signed certificate, are you really sure? Don't just click yes and accept everything, right? The system is trying to tell you something. Unfortunately, a lot of the time it's telling you something which is irrelevant, or it's telling you something you can do nothing about. So it's either visit the site or don't visit the site. But it is actually trying to tell you something and you should pay attention to it. You might just get into the habit of clicking, yeah, whatever, and you shouldn't really do that. If you really care, then you pay attention to that and you don't go through. When the system's warning you about something, you don't go through that. The problem is that a lot of the time those warnings are either irrelevant or you can do nothing about it other than stop whatever you're doing, which is often not acceptable to people.
Is there a way you could circumvent any of those problems, though? I mean, private browsing or anything like that?
Private browsing attempts to stop information leaking between browsing sessions. But fundamentally, private browsing or not, you're going to the website and it's the wrong website and it's got malware on it, then your browser's still going to get owned, right? Or, you know, if you type in your bank details and you've typed them into the wrong website, then you still type them into the wrong website. Private browsing doesn't help with that.
We can also have another one with its state and the operations around it. And this can represent the other paddle. So we've got two objects.
A virtual world on your everyday physical experience.
Let's get the Google Glass in there. There it is. I think I'd be tempted to position it a bit further along the line here.